Well, you ready for the word? What a wonderful place to be on a Sunday morning. Amen. To hear from God, receive from God. Amen. It's good to have the Fords here. God bless you. Jerry, Yvonne, hallelujah. We love you. Praise the Lord. Well, you have your Bible? Go to John chapter 14, verse 26, please. That's good. Praise the Lord. Oh, the word is good. It's good news. It's gospel. Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you for your word. Lord, we expect to receive revelation from heaven this morning, that you would speak through my vocal cords, think through my mind, that this word would come forth unhindered and uninterrupted by any satanic or demonic force. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us ears to hear and hearts to understand. Thank you, Lord, for wisdom, insight, revelation, and understanding that flows from your throne. Thank you, Father, that we walk in the wisdom of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm teaching a series entitled Living the Good Life. How many of you know that God has a good life for us to live? Well, as a born-again believer, we have access to that good life. But just because you're born again doesn't mean you always experience the good life. Why? Because everything from God, every promise from God, we must receive by faith, right? We have to have knowledge of it, and we have to receive it or take it by faith. And what I want to talk about specifically this morning, my subtopic, is the help of the Holy Ghost. The help of the Holy Ghost. So we begin reading here in the verse 26. It says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. How many of you have ever been under pressure in life and you just felt like going home and going to bed in the middle of the day? And one of the things that you'll notice that is on most people's bed is something called a comforter, right? But how many of you know that you have one who is the comforter, who is the Holy Ghost, who can bring a comfort to you without going home and even laying on that bed, right? And I'm telling you, the person of the Holy Ghost is the great comforter. And he knows how to comfort us in our lives unlike anyone else knows how to comfort. Unlike any drug, anything in a person's life, anything alcohol, it might be comforting to go lay in a hammock and drink an iced tea in the Keys, right? But there is no one that can comfort us like the Holy Ghost. No one. No one. Nothing brings the comfort like the Holy Ghost. You need to know that. You need to be reminded of that if you already know it. Amen? And it says, the Comforter, who is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. You know, it's comforting when you know. Amen? And the enemy likes to work in the unknown. Well, and then in the unknown, he tries to induce fear upon a person's life because of perhaps what you don't know. But be comforted, because the Holy Ghost will teach you what you need to know. He will reveal to you what you need to know. Amen. Hallelujah. Great enthusiasm early. That's good. All right. I'm speaking faith. All right. And bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. And he goes on in this same verse and he says, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Say that with me. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Now, I tell you that in an area when you're reading the scriptures and there's a portion that something that you need to do, it's your responsibility. For me, I circle it in my Bible. The let not, because I have a part to play in that letting not. Because he's already done it for us, but I still have to choose to let not my heart be troubled, and to let not my heart be afraid. I've got to let not. I've got to do it. How do I do it? By faith in his word that says, I have a comforter. By faith in his word that says, I have one who will give me peace that the world cannot give me. So all the world, I could search the world all the way around and not find the peace that the peace of the Holy Ghost can give me. Amen. But I have to choose to receive that peace by faith. Say, I have the peace of God. And I receive the peace of God, the person of the Holy Ghost, by faith. You see what you just did? You let not. You let not. Amen. Now, let me jump over here in chapter 16, verse 12. He says, I have yet many things to say unto you. Say many things. So he's got many things he wants to say to us, right? I love that. Because everything he has to say to us is good. Everything that he has to say to us is beneficial. Everything that he has to say to us is a benefit. Amen. It's a blessing. He doesn't just say stuff just to talk. Ever been around somebody who just doesn't seem to know how to stop talking? And you're like, are you still talking? And they're still talking. And they just talk. And they don't really say much, but they sure talk a lot, right? That's not the Holy Spirit. He is very precise what he says. And what he says to you, every word is beneficial to you. So when he speaks, listen. Because what he has to say to you brings comfort to you, brings the peace of God to you, brings wisdom to you, brings insight to you, brings understanding to you. Everything that he says is a help to you. Amen? Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost. They wrote a song about it. Amen? He says he has many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit he, the Holy Spirit of truth, the Spirit of truth, is come. He will guide you. Now, how many know the Holy Spirit has come? Because he's prophesying of the Holy Spirit to come. So now we are living in the dispensation where we have the Holy Spirit, right? So he says, the Spirit of truth is come. He will guide you into all truth. Say, all truth. Now, you got to understand that in our society, people are trying to become slick. I'm trying to think of a better word to say. With their words. What they're really saying, what they're really being is deceptive with their words. And they try to use these words just so that if you try to hold them to what they said, they say, well, you know, I really wasn't saying that when I said that. And you go, well, what are you trying to say? Well, you know, and they just dance around all the time. That is not how the Holy Spirit communicates to us. When he speaks to us, he is speaking truth to our life. So he doesn't speak one thing, and then you go, well, you know, maybe he really didn't mean that. No, he really meant that. He really meant that. Okay? Hallelujah. When God speaks, he really meant it. Amen. Amen. And you, in fact, so much, you know, this is an expression, you could take it to the bank, right? Because it is truth. I mean, pure truth, holy truth for our lives. Amen. And so he says, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. Who will do that? The Holy Spirit. So do you need anyone else other than the Holy Spirit? You don't need tarot cards. You don't need, the zodiac stuff. All that is a counterfeit and is not good. It's witchcraft, to be frank with you, okay? Because you have the Holy Spirit. And the things that you need to know and see, he will show it to you. He'll reveal it to you. Amen. Amen. He shall glorify me, Jesus is speaking, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. That word show there is also described as transmit. Say transmit. Now, I remember the first time I ever heard this or ever read this, and then when I was studying, and I revealed that that word show also means to transmit, and because I had, you know, this is many years ago, and I had just gotten a cell phone a few years before that, and I mean, that in itself was absolutely amazing. You know, how many of you had the long cords that, like, stretched all the way across the living room? And then you'd overstretch them, and then you'd let go, and they'd just kind of like do this number. So you're on the phone, and you're trying to undo the cord and not trip over everything else. Some of you remember those days. Some of you have no idea what I'm talking about, all right? You know, then you get a new phone, you know, and then your mom says, don't pull too far because it's going to stretch it out, right? So getting a cell phone that I'm talking and I'm not connected was pretty amazing, right? Well, I'm telling you that the Holy Spirit is the great transmitter. And you know what we are to be? The great receivers. We are to receive what he's transmitting to our lives. And he's transmitting. And by the way, he is transmitting 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. He's never offline. You'll get a kick out of this. Jeff and Jake are on vacation this week. And when I was just getting started in computer stuff, and you know, they were light years advanced in their knowledge of technology than I was. And Jeff, I was doing something, and he had, you know, Google was relatively new at the time, and I'm doing something, and I go to type in, and it didn't work. Like it said, I don't know what it said, but didn't work. I call him up, and I'm like, I'm trying to do this, but I'm like, I guess Google's down. And he laughed. And laughed and laughed and laughed. And I go, what? He goes, Google is not down. He said, it's your Wi-Fi that's down. But back in the day, you know, I didn't know. I'm like, well, it's not working. It must be Google's fault, right? No, wasn't Google's fault. It was our fault, right? Something going on. Of course, years later, do you remember when Google went down for a day? I said, yeah, I prophesied. I said, I told you it was going to go down. I said, you just wait. It's going to go down. Oh, but what am I saying? He's transmitting. The problem is not with the transmitter, who is the Holy Spirit. The issue always would be those who would receive. Because there are so many things that can distract. There are so many things that can get our attention. There are so many things that are, you know, if you're, oh, I got all this worry and all this care. Hey, be comforted. He's transmitting truth. He's giving you what you need to know. He's revealing to you what you need to know. He will show you what you need to know. Say, he'll show me, what I need to know. Praise God. Now go to Mark chapter 16. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Because this has been the foundational verse for this teaching, living the good life. And my prayer is that everyone in this church is living the good life. And that good life is the life that Jesus Christ has died and paid for us. Because the more I know about God, the more I know and believe that he wants us to live a good life. And even a better life than last year, and a better life than the year before, and a better life than the year before that. Amen? Just always ever increasing. Mark 16, 15 says, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world and do what? Preach the gospel. What's the gospel? Good news, right? Preach the good news to every creature. Why is he telling them to preach the good news? Because there have been so many bad things and so many wrong misconceptions of who God is. And we still see the seed of that deception in the earth today, of people who really don't know just how good God is, okay? So he's going, go and tell them the good news of what? The good news of who God is. Amen. All right. That was free. He that believeth, how many is a believer in here? He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Glory to God. He that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe, right? In my name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not harm them. They shall lay hands. By the way, I drank a Mountain Dew last night. Don't recommend it. But I had one. Just being transparent, okay? Don't hate. Look at my wife. Some of you had some too. You know it. You know it. Of course, I was thinking of this verse when I was drinking it. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Amen? Jesus said these signs would follow the believer. So these signs are to be following our life. Amen? And he never said that these signs would only follow a few, special few. No, these signs would follow the believer. Amen? Now, believers, there are many people who believe in Jesus. There are many people who are going to heaven, but they don't believe in the gift of the Holy Spirit and speaking in other tongues. And the reason I'm teaching that and I'm zeroing in on that is because I'm teaching this series, Living the Good Life, and the Spirit of the Lord directed me and said, you got to teach them this. Because I know in my experience, but I also know from the Word of God, that this is a gift from God and it is a blessing for your life. And if you've never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the evidence of speaking in other tongues, I just want to encourage you to do so because it is part of the experience in living the good life. Okay? Now, with having said that, I want to keep moving on here. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I'm not going to go over all the verses that I have in the last few weeks. If you haven't been here, we make these messages available online free, and we also will burn a CD for you free so you have them. Because if it's free, guess what? No excuse. Well, I didn't know, God. Well, you went to the church and they told you it was free. Oh, I guess that's true. So, 1 Corinthians 14, 2. You know, praying in the Spirit is speaking to God. It's praying to God. It's communicating with God. It's communicating with the language of heaven. And 1 Corinthians 14, 2 says, for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. Not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the Spirit, say in the Spirit.
In the Spirit.
In the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. Now this word speaketh mysteries could also be said like this, and I think it'll help your understanding. In the Spirit, he speaketh divine secrets. Why? Because God has things that are laid up for his children, for the children of God, for believers, that are mysterious to the world, that are secrets that are not held from us, but for us. God knows the secret to success. And I'm telling you, you can tap into God's secret to success by the Holy Ghost. That's how you tap into it. And I'm telling you, when you begin to pray and you begin to pray in the Spirit, what are you praying? Oh, glory to God, you are praying the divine secrets of God. He knows the secret to success in every area of your life. He knows how to prosper you in every area of your life. Amen. Listen to the New Living Translation. It says, for if you have the ability to speak in tongues, you will be talking only to God. Since people won't be able to understand you, you will be speaking by the power of the Spirit. By the power of the Spirit. Say that with me. By the power of the Spirit. Glory to God. And I'm telling you, the devil gets absolutely frustrated when a Christian prays in the Spirit because he is completely ignorant to what is being communicated when a believer is praying in the Spirit. And when a believer prays in the Spirit, they are now communicating, fellowshipping with their Heavenly Father, and God will reveal and speak back to your spirit and give you and reveal to you and show you what you need to know. We watched a video a few weeks ago on a Thursday night. We did it again as we closed out the service. Some of you may have seen it, and we'll probably show it to you. In fact, look, you know what? You got it ready? Is it ready there?
I'm Pastor Jeff Herbert, and this is my wife, Linda.
This just in, you are looking at obviously a very disturbing live shot there. That is the World Trade Center, and we have unconfirmed reports this morning that a plane has crashed into one of the towers.
My wife is a retired Army colonel, and she was in the Pentagon on 9/11, right in the strike zone.
On that fateful day of 9/11, I was walking down the corridor towards my office. It was a very unusual morning in the office. We saw planes going into the World Trade Center, and we thought it was a spoof. You know, we thought it was a movie spoof or something, because who would think that there's planes going into the World Trade Center? And right at that moment, my superiors called us all together, and we were put into another office, and we were told that we were going on a 24-hour full alert. As I was moving down the corridor of the Pentagon, the plane impacted right in the area where my office was.
Jane, we're just getting a report that there's been an attack on the Pentagon. This is the Pentagon.
This is
from the network. This is the Pentagon in Arlington, Virginia.
And my superior stopped to talk to me. And because he stopped to talk to me, I was positioned rightly behind a beam. And that was one of the ways that the Lord saved me, by the way, was because when the plane came in, you know, it had 10,000 gallons of jet fuel. And all of that exploded. It was traumatic and it was instantaneous. And it was at that moment that someone yelled, "Get down," and we were all a bunch of military people, so we all hit the floor immediately. Here I am on the floor, if you can picture this, and I'm in tongues, audible tongues, because at this point, and I'm scared, everybody's scared, we don't know what's going on. And I even wondered in my mind, you know, is somebody attacking the Pentagon? Are there, because there was too many explosions for an earthquake. I mean, everything was exploding, the infrastructure. You know, things were popping all around and was explosions going off. And of course, you don't know which way to turn. You don't know what is happening. So the only thing you have to guide you is the Spirit. And the next thing that I heard, it just welled up within me, and I heard, "Get out now." I saw a quick vision of one set of doors. And I knew, so I knew the Spirit was telling me, get out, do it right now, and go out those doors. And I started running down this bay. And I got to the corridor where I had a choice now. I had another corridor choice. And the Lord was saying to me, go left, go left, go left. I made a left turn, and then I heard run, 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 because I was really kind of skeptical about, am I really going in the right direction? Because things were exploding. And as I was running down this corridor, there were doors that were glass doors from other entryways, and they were exploding. Mm-hmm. And they had just installed this automated smoke door. I didn't even know it was there. And I came up on it full throttle. To this day, I don't know who that person was, but there was some tall gentleman who opened that door right at that moment, and all of us shot through that door, and we got to a place of safety. And when I was on the floor and I heard that, get out now, I had a colleague that I was in eye contact with. He guesstimated it was about 17 seconds from the time I got up from the floor that I went to that other corridor where God said make a left turn. It was about 17 seconds. Within that time frame, a fireball came through and scorched everybody in its path. That's a miracle. That's a miracle of God. People later came to me, they said, "Linda, when we saw you get off the floor, we knew that you were a preacher and a Jesus freak, and so we were gonna follow you out the door." If I had not instantaneously obeyed God, I would have died. And so that's why it's so important, you know, that we hear the voice of God and we obey.
And our message has always been hear and obey. Why if God took the sovereign God of the universe takes the time to tell you something, why would you not do it?
And you know, we've always been positive confessors. We've always been one to follow the teachings of Kenneth Copeland. He's been a mainstream in our life. And we are real big on having the Word on the inside of us. You've got to be able to pull that Word out right now. And even, you know, when you're learning to hear God's voice, you need to know that those thoughts are lining up with the Word of God. And so, but you've got to have it within your spirit.
Just guard your heart. Keep that Word in your heart, because that's where faith comes from. Amen. Keep your heart and your mouth aligned with what God says, and you'll come through.
Amen.
Praise God, huh? Turn the lights back on, please. What is the Lord doing? transmitting, helping, saving, always, always being a help, always being help. I'm telling you, it is so important. Last week, I read to you the importance of communication while at war, right? And I read about how the ability to receive and use information is critically important on the battlefield. And it can spell the difference between victory or defeat at a time of war. And I'm telling you, it can mean the difference between life and death, I believe, for us as believers. Notice what she was doing? She said, I was praying in tongues audibly out loud because her mind didn't know what to do. She said, we were afraid. We were scared, you know? And, you know, I made a point that at the Battle of Midway, how we were able to intercept the Japanese communication, and that made the difference for us in that war, to be able to win that war. And of course, you know, as I spoke also last week, how we employed the Navajo Indians and utilized their language in the Second World War, I believe, was also to be able to communicate effectively to our people, because our communication was constantly being decoded and deciphered by the enemy, and so they knew what we were doing before we would do it. But when we adapted their language and took upon their language, things begin to change. We won the war as a result of it. So I'm telling you, communication is extremely important. God knows that. He knows that. That's why He set a system up, a communication system by the Holy Spirit to communicate to you and for you to communicate to Him. And the enemy cannot intercept that. So there may be areas in your life that maybe you're challenged, and you can pray in the Spirit, and the enemy doesn't even know what you're praying about. And then you can receive the answer to what you're praying about, and he still doesn't know. And then you can act in faith in what you hear here to avoid tragedy, to avoid failure. You know, the Bible says he never allows the uncompromisingly righteous to be made to move, slip, fail, or fall. That's pretty powerful, people. I just so enjoy what Minister Leslie says. He says, we are at the right place. This is like one of his things. We are at the right place at the right time all the time. That should be a confession over our life. I'm at the right place at the right time all the time. Well, you know what the world says? Well, you know, I was just at the wrong place at the wrong time, you know? Well, God knows how to put us in the right place at the right time, every time, all the time. And so that should be our confession of faith. That should be what we believe, and that should be what we receive. You know what she said? I had to act immediately, obey immediately. You know, immediate obedience is always the best obedience, right? No, I'm guilty. I haven't always obeyed immediately on things, you know. Like I drank the Mountain Dew yesterday, but I'm listening, all right? I know I shouldn't be drinking it. What am I saying, though? Quickly. Obey God quickly. Hear from God. He'll transmit to you that fast. See, a lot of people think they pray and then they have to wait, you know, umpteen years and I may or may not hear from God. No, God will speak to you. And he'll speak quickly to you. He'll talk to your heart. Amen? You know, in 14:14, he says, For if I pray in tongues, my spirit is praying, but I don't understand what I'm saying. And just because somebody doesn't understand what they're saying doesn't mean it's not important. I mean, in the natural, just because, you know, have you ever been around somebody who's maybe an engineer, or maybe a computer programmer, or maybe in the medical field? You notice how they use a lot of words? Different fields will use a lot of words. And if you just came in there, you're like, what are you saying? I don't even know what you're talking about. I mean, can you say it again? Can you say it so I can understand it? Now, people that are in that field of profession, they understand what they're saying, right? But you may not quite understand, and they're even speaking English. As far as you know, they are, right? But I'm telling you that God, he speaks to us, and as we pray in the Spirit, we can be using words that our understanding doesn't know, but our spirit does know. It does know, and it will receive what it needs to know. Amen? Hallelujah. And how about when God gave instruction to Noah? He gave instruction to Noah in the Bible to build an ark. It never rained, folks. Build this massive boat. Can you imagine all the excuses that Noah could have came up with? Can you imagine all the excuses people today would have come up, could come up with? Well, God, you know, I don't think they'll give me a permit to build it. I mean, we have all the technology, hydraulics, electricity, everything nowadays, and it still would be a big task to take on to build that boat. All those thousands of years, God is speaking to this man, Noah, to build an ark. And what was that ark going to do? It was going to save humanity from destruction, man. It encapsulated his family and protected them from the flood, right? I'm telling you, God is still giving instruction for our life to protect our lives from danger. I'm telling you, this is the God we serve. And I'm telling you, God will reveal to your spirit exactly what you need to know for your life in any situation. God is a precise God. I like, you know, that's why I like that story, because it's like he showed me, he gave me a vision. Just, I mean, this is happening this quick. Explosion goes off. He gave me a vision of doors. She gets up. You know, she could say, well, God, I don't know where those doors are. So, no, she got up. She began to put faith into action. She gets to the door. There's a big man standing in front of the door. Probably an angel. Open the door, right? They go through the door. They're all saved. Ah, glory to God. Got to remember, God's really smart. He's really, really, really smart, right? And he knows. But in all his smartness, he wants to help you. His biggest, greatest desire is to help you. That's what blesses him more than anything, is to be a help to you. It's not like, oh, I know God knows everything, but here I am, this little peon, you know, and you know. No. God does not look at you. You are God's most prized possession. And he wants to help you in every area of your life. In Matthew 7, 9, it says, parents, if your children ask for a loaf of bread, do you give them a stone? Or if they ask you for a fish, do you give them a snake? He says, of course not. He says, so if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask him? And I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit is a good gift. The person of the Holy Spirit is the best gift, really. Listen to Luke 11, 13. It says, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? What do you have to do? Ask him. That isn't that difficult. Ask him. Right? You know, when you pray in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit is giving you exactly what you need. Exactly what you need. And this is so important, because you don't have all the answers. You don't see the whole picture. But he knows everything, and he wants to help you. He sees the whole picture from the end to the beginning, and he wants to reveal to you exactly what you need to know, exactly what steps you need to take. You know, the Bible says in Psalms, right, the Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. What is that? God, can you see the picture of who God is? He's constantly wanting to help us with every area of our life, every walk, every step, every decision. Now, people go, man, you're a pastor and you take it a little bit too far, a little fanatical. This isn't just for pastors. This is for the body of Christ. This is for God's children. He desires to help each and every one of us. The comforter of the Holy Ghost is for every one of us. The one who is to lead us and guide us into all truth is for all of us. Every one of us. Every one of us. You get this? Every one of us in every area of life. There's a woman that goes to this church who's a nurse. And she was visiting my father when he had open heart surgery, and the surgery was over, and he was in intensive care or ICU, whatever it was. And she saw him and said, "Well, I'll come say goodbye to you before I leave my shift," because she happened to know we were there and stuff like that. And she got busy and had to work late, longer than her shift was supposed to be. She was just exhausted and tired. I can't even imagine. That's a very intense job. God bless you, everyone who does that. And so she goes out, she goes down, she goes out to her car to leave her shift. And it was like a 12-hour shift, plus she works extra hours. She gets out to her car, and the Holy Spirit reminded her that she said that she was going to go see him before she got off her shift. She's going to come back you know, at some point, or she could have went home to get, she just wanted to get some rest and go eat. And guess what? She followed the Holy Spirit and she went back up there. She walks in his room and he was like coding out, but nobody was getting it. Nobody even knew it. And she yelled down the hallway and they all came running and they got involved there. I don't even remember the details, but you could help me out probably there. And they were able to help him to save his life. I firmly believe that if she wouldn't have followed and listened to the Holy Spirit, I don't think my dad probably would be on this earth today. Instead, he's in the back, praise God, and he makes your CDs afterwards. I don't take that lightly. I really don't take that lightly. I absolutely believe that she heard from the Spirit of God, and she obeyed. She actually obeyed. She actually listened to him, is what I mean by that. And she followed him, and she went back up there and helped. I'm telling you, maybe not to that degree, but I believe there's probably people in your life that are quote-unquote coding out, not in a hospital room perhaps, but people around you that are maxed out, stressed out, worried, and they might put a good game face on even. I mean, I know too many people who have committed suicide that they said, we didn't even know there's anything wrong, anything going on. It's not always the person that says, oh, I'm thinking about ending my life. I don't know if I can go on. Many times it's not that person. You hear what I'm saying? Listen to the Holy Spirit. Because as he instructs you, you help, you obey. Because he may be telling you about somebody that you need to help, that you need to minister to, okay? And I'm telling you, don't just ignore it. Don't just think it's no big deal. Pay attention. Listen to him. Reach out to him. Could be one of your own family members. Could be one of your own children. They could be adults. Could be one of your own children. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Drag them to church if you have to. Tell them about the Lord. Tell them God can help you. God will help you. And we're going to stand by your side and help you too. Amen. Yes. I'm preaching to you now this morning. Amen. Yes. Magnifying the problem. You know, many people today choose to magnify the problem. It has been, I just think this has grown too. I hear more people talk about problems than solutions. How many know for every problem there's already a solution? God already has a solution. And the Holy Ghost already knows how to give you that solution. Every problem, every epidemic, every one. Hallelujah. But it's really difficult to hear the solution if you're talking about the problem, meditating on the problem, thinking about the problem, the problem, the problem, the problem, the problem. There is one who is a solution giver, and it's the Holy Ghost. And Acts 10:46 says, "For they heard them speaking with tongues and magnifying God." Say that with me. Speaking in tongues and magnifying God. Now, God can't get any bigger than he already is, but he can become bigger to you. For example, you know, if I took a magnifying glass over the pages of my Bible, right, the words would appear bigger to me, wouldn't they? Now, the words themselves don't actually get any bigger, but it appears bigger to me. And I'm telling you that praying in tongues magnifies God. God becomes bigger in you than the problems that are outside of you and around you, okay? And so this is another important part of speaking in tongues, because as you speak in tongues, you pray in tongues, you begin to magnify the Lord. When you pray in the Spirit, especially in a situation where you don't know what to do, praying in tongues is a really good idea. Because your mind goes, I don't know what to do. That lady, she said, we didn't know what was happening. She's like, are we being attacked? Are we not being attacked? What'd she do? She prayed in the Spirit. How did she do that? Well, because she did it before she got in that moment of crisis. And so that's why I recommend don't just doing it in a situation where your back's up against the wall, so to speak, but do it on a regular basis. You're driving down the road. Turn the radio off for a little bit. Stop looking for Pokemon. I had to throw it in there, right? Trying to help. And pray in the Spirit. Don't pray in the Spirit to find Pokemon, okay? Oh, I know he's around your... No. But when you pray in the Spirit, you're immediately magnifying God and not the problem. You can't be praying in the Spirit and magnifying the problem at the same time. And I'm telling you, in areas of life, if you've struggled in areas of life, in temptation, in any area of temptation in your life, praying in the Spirit is a great way to overcome that temptation. It's a great way to overcome that. Because what you begin to do is you begin to magnify God in you. And you begin, you know, worry, great opportunity to pray in the Spirit. If you're a chronic worrier, pray in the Spirit. If you're a chronic complainer, pray in the Spirit. Amen? Amen? I'm telling you, you may be surprised how fast you can overcome worry. Amen? I'm telling you, you get to the place where God is so big. God is so big, it doesn't matter what comes at you. You're just like, are you kidding me? Well, I can handle that. I can overcome that. And you begin to pray in the Spirit because I know the one who knows. I know the one who knows. And what happens to some people, though, is when they talk about and they magnify the problem, I have counseled with many people in 15 years now of ministry, and pretty quickly you can identify where they're at. And what I mean by that is if they magnify the problem that they're there for the counseling for greater than God, or they magnify God greater than the problem, and they just need some help getting there. And so in your own life, you got to ask yourself, what am I magnifying the most in my life? Because the enemy wants to get you to the point to where you think that even God himself couldn't help you in your problem. That husband, my wife, that situation at work, I'm done. I mean, it's over. That. I mean, it's just too far. Nothing is too far for God. No one is too far gone for God. And I'll tell you this, no marriage is too far gone for God. No situation is too far gone for God. No financial situation is too far gone for God. Amen. You need to hear from God on it, right? And if you're married, here's to hear from, no, I won't go there. Stay married. Believe God. Now, then there's, I would say, don't stay in an abusive relationship. I want to say that. You know, if you're getting abused, it's not like, oh, you just got to stay with him. No, you don't stay there, okay? Glory to God. Well, I just have to say it sometimes because some people can get confused, right? But what I'm telling you is that even in that, you begin to pray. You begin to pray in the Spirit. You begin to hear from God, right? So you know exactly what to do, where to go. Glory to God. Go to Romans 8:26. I'll try to close out here. Romans 8:26. I'm going to read this out of the Amplified Bible. Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 26 says, so, too, the Holy Spirit comes to our aid. Glory to God. It says he comes to our aid. Isn't that good news? Yeah. And bears us up in our weakness. He bears us up in our weakness. How many know that the Holy Spirit knows your weakness? In fact, he knows your weakness better than you know your weakness. But he knows that the Bible says, you know what the Bible says? Let the weak say, I am strong. See the difference there? What is that? That's faith talking. You're feeling weak? You don't say, I sure am weak. You know how many people, I heard a secular report on this. How many chronic fatigue and how many people are experiencing chronic fatigue? The numbers have just increased greatly. It's crazy. But you know, ever since I heard that report, I was listening. How many people say they are so tired? I told you what the lady at Dunkin' Donuts, when she said how tired she was, you know what I did? I said, put your hand out. She put her hand out, slapped my hand out, in the name of Jesus, and I began to pray for right through the drive-thru. Freaked her out. I have not gone through that. When I pull up in that drive-thru, hey! Now, if she's tired, she ain't going to let me know she's tired. Well, what are we doing? Kind of wake some people up, man, all right? Didn't say, you know, didn't say let the weak say, I sure am tired, I sure am weak. No, the Bible says let the weak say, I am strong. Amen? So we can say we're strong, can't we? And we should say we're strong. Why? Because the Bible says it, right? And the Holy Spirit, it says the Holy Spirit, he comes to our aid. Time of weakness, time of he comes to our weak, he comes to our aid to bear us up in our weakness. So even at a weak state, he's going to bear you up. For we do not know what prayer to offer, nor how to offer it worthy as we ought. But the Spirit himself, glory to God, but the Spirit himself, who? The Spirit himself, right? Goes to meet our supplication. I love that. That is another picture of how much God cares about us, isn't it? To meet our supplication and plead in our behalf with unspeakable yearnings and groanings too deep for utterance. Glory to God, I just want to pray in the Spirit. And he who searches the hearts of men knows what is in the mind of the Holy Spirit, what his intent is, because the Spirit intercedes and pleads before God in our behalf of the saints, according to and in harmony with God's will. Look at the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Comes to our aid to bear us up. In 1 Corinthians, it says, he who speaks, 14:4 says, he who speaks in a strange tongue edifies and improves himself. Edifies and improves himself. Praying in the Spirit edifies you. Praying in the Spirit is a way to spiritually build yourself up. Can you see why he's tried to keep the enemy? Satan has tried to keep this from the body of Christ. He don't want a bunch of strong, edified Christians. He wants a bunch of weaklings who don't know what to do, who sit there and go, well, he works in mysterious ways. No, the Holy Spirit is given to us to reveal those mysteries. The Holy Spirit is given to us to come to our aid, to bear us up, to help us, so that we will magnify God and edify ourselves. Do you see the person of the Holy Spirit and why the enemy has worked so hard to make people think, well, the churches that are Spirit-filled, I mean, it's amazing how many people, when they find out I'm a pastor, the one thing they want to know, they don't always have the guts to ask me, are you Spirit-filled? Are you Spirit-filled? Because in their mind, most religious people, if you're Spirit-filled, they're not going. But those who know and ask, I can always tell the difference. Because they ask, are you Spirit-filled? Oh, yeah. You better believe it, baby. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. I mean, and hey, Spirit-filled isn't just like non-denominational churches, right? There are Catholic churches that are Spirit-filled. I was doing work years ago at a church down in Clearwater, a Catholic church down there, and the lady that was running this thing, and we were talking, we'd been talking about the Lord, and the guy that was working with me said, oh, he's a Christian, and he's Spirit-filled or something like that. She goes, Spirit-filled? She goes, well, we're Spirit-filled. I said, praise God. And we were talking, she goes, yeah, we have prayer meetings. She goes, we pray in tongues, we flop on the floor, and we run around the building. All right, get down with your bad self, girl. I mean, but you could just see the life in her. She was probably 70s to 80 years old, but just the life of God is in her. I'm telling you, that's the life of the Spirit of God. Glory to God. There's just something about the Holy Ghost. You know, You need edifying. You need built up. For goodness sakes, your smartphone needs it. That word edifying in the Greek, it's describing a charging. It's a charging of your spirit when you pray in tongues. The charge is your spirit. It's sad to say how much I use my phone. This week, I was working, doing things, and I plugged my phone in, and I didn't realize it wasn't taking a charge. And so, you know, I'm going about, and I look, 7%. That's like borderline panic for me, all right? I mean, I kept my cool, but I was not too cool, all right? Made my important phone calls. I got 7%. If I fall off the face of the earth, I'll be back. That's what I felt like. What I realized is I had all my appointments. I had my whole entire to-do list. I had my list of stuff that I needed to get at the store, all in my phone. And by the time I got to Verizon, it was 2%. And my son goes, well, what are you going to do? Got to love it when your 10-year-old asks you what you're going to do. And you know what I said to him? I'm going to believe God. And he goes, all right. So we go in there. But this is good. This is how you teach your children. We go in there. He does all his monkeying around. He couldn't figure it out. Because I can't get it to work. And he goes, what's your password? Well, I figured I knew my password. Well, apparently I don't. Tried every password I know, most of which are probably stored in the silly phone to begin with. So he couldn't access my account. I'm like, I can give you every other piece of information. Nope, gotta have a password. Oh yeah, my son's just watching this whole thing go down. So you know what I begin to do? He's over there monkeying around. He's like, I don't know what to do for you. I begin to pray in the spirit. In the Verizon store. Not super loud, but I did. I walked away from the counter. My son's watched me. So you know what he did? My son joined his faith with me. Because we were trying to get some stuff done, and he was helping me. And we're standing there, and he goes, I'll try it one more time. God plays. He goes, it's working. It's taking a charge. He goes, I don't even know. I didn't even do anything more. Just, it's taking a charge. My son's face. Grabbed that phone, plugged it in, went on the rest of the day. I know that sounds far out and freaky for some of you in the room, but some of you go, nope, I do it all the time. All I'm saying is trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Amen? Stand to your feet, please. Will he show you where you're supposed to live? Yep. Will he show you what church to go to? Yep. Praying in the Spirit edifies you. And some Christians, I think, have become limited in their effect because of the lack of spiritual power that they're operating in their life. But they have access to that power. They have access to that power, but they're not tapping into that power. They're not relying on and depending on the power of the Holy Spirit. So I'm teaching you this teaching and how to live the good life, because you can't truly experience living the good life without tapping into the power of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for your holy word. Thank you that we have the ability, the opportunity to build ourselves up in our most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. If there's anyone here that has never received Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, what we read in the beginning of this time together was those who believe will be saved. Those who don't will be damned. Not because God is the damner, because he's not. Satan is the damner. Receive in Jesus' name. Receive God's saving grace this morning by faith. Receive the gift of the Holy Spirit right now by faith. Just right now, just as you're standing here. Receive him now. Receive him now. With your mouth, believe in your heart, Jesus is the Son of God. Say this with me. Heavenly Father, I believe that your Son Jesus came to this earth, died on a cross, was buried in a tomb, and rose again, and is alive now, and seated at the right hand of the Father. I receive Jesus as my Lord and the Savior of my life. I denounce my sin. I repent of my past. And I, from this day forward, I will live for you, Lord. Holy Spirit, fill me so that I may receive your fullness, all that you have for me in my life. Thank you, Lord, for my heavenly prayer language. In Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, just worship the Lord now, just for a minute. If you pray in the Spirit, just pray in the Spirit. reservoir of the wisdom of God, God's insight, God's understanding, the knowledge of God. And as you receive from His great reservoir, you are receiving of the great comfort. Because as you know, and you receive by faith, it'll bring comfort to your life. It's the comfort you need. Because out of that comfort will bring confidence. No more days of being unsure. No more days of being unsettled in your spirit. No more fearful days. No more worry. Receive from His great reservoir of wisdom, His great reservoir of insight, His great reservoir of understanding. Receive what you need for your life, for your very specific direction. He is very precise, and He cares about even the smallest of details of your life. Choose to magnify the Lord. Choose to make Him bigger than any problem, than any circumstance. Follow the One who is the great administrator. Listen to the One who is the great operator. And allow the manifestation of the Holy Spirit to reveal Himself to your life. He is the great architect. And He knows how to initiate, to administrate, and to manifest. Consider the One whose fingers place the moon and the stars in the sky. Consider the One who held the oceans in His hand. Consider the One who weighed out the balance of the earth and the mountains and the hills in the scales of His hands. Listen to His advice. Seek His advice. Seek His direction. For all the nations of the world are but a drop in the bucket. But He can pick up the whole earth as though it were a grain of sand. So just think of how He can help you in your life. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. written years ago. And it says, Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. I'd like us to sing that together. But I'd like you to sing it this way. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in my life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Praise God. About the Holy Spirit is he moves at the speed of light, but he's never in a hurry. God's healing, God's provision for some of you. Some of you received understanding that you didn't have before. Some of you are just beginning to see the insight of who the Holy Spirit is. This is kind of new. to others, it is reaffirming what you've heard for perhaps years. But make no mistake, everyone in this room is here on purpose. Not just that you purposed to be here, but that God purposed for you to be here. Because the Bible says that He knew you before the foundations of the earth. He knew all the days of your life. I encourage you to receive everything that the Spirit of God has for you this morning, and don't leave this room until you get it. You grab a hold of your healing, you grab a hold of your deliverance, you grab a hold of whatever it is by faith. And when you know that you got it, then leave. I know it's a bold statement. God's all about delivering. It isn't God holding back. Receive. Receive. Thank you. We saw your saving grace, your saving truth, and now we see the truth. Now we have light of the truth. Thank you, Lord, for saving us, for allowing us to see what we were blinded from in darkness because of your great light. We walk in the light as you're in the light. We live in the light, never to return to the darkness. In Jesus' name, amen. I believe that you got what you came here for. And if not, you're welcome to stay. But before you leave this room, what the Spirit of the Lord said is you grab a hold of and take by faith what you came here for. With that, I'll dismiss those who want to be dismissed. You're the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, blessed going in and blessed going out. And everything you set your hand to prospers. You're the lender, not the borrower. You're good looking, you're dismissed. We'll see you.